Hello, everyone, and welcome to Day 2 of Fort Wayne, Indiana's Pokémon Trading Card Game Regional Championships. I am host Wade Kremser-Ohano here with Kenny Wisdom, and it is early in the morning, my friend. We have been here all night last night, and we are right back early as can be for Day 2.
Absolutely, and we've got quite the matchup for you guys with two former regional champions from this season. We've got Michael Pramawat and Jimmy O'Brien, so it's going to be an incredible matchup. It's pretty rare that you get to feature two regional champions from the same season you're playing in. But with a stacked tournament like we've got today, that's just kind of what happens.
Yeah, well, what ended up happening was we cut to 32 players to begin day two. We had 490 masters come in for day one, and only 32 of them made day two. So 32 of them are here in the morning competing for a chance at making the top eight cut. They've got to go through five more Swiss rounds in order to do so. Guess what, though? The top two seeds are Michael Pramawat and Jimmy O'Brien. Jimmy has yet to drop a Swiss round. He's yet to drop a round, period, in his two weekends of regionals now.
Yeah, he was, I believe, 16-0-1 at the Lancaster Regional Championship,
eight,
and now he is 8-0-2.
8-0-1, yeah.
Sorry, 8-0-1, so just has not lost a game. The streak is alive, and Pram's looking to end it, I'll tell you that.
Hashtag the streak. And you know what? That is true. Pramawat, just last night, was talking about how he wanted to face against Jimmy O'Brien. He wanted to be the one to end the streak. And go figure, he's going to have a chance to do so. But let's not get too ahead of ourselves. There's still 30 other players that are also going to be competing today. And each and every one of these guys has a chance at making the top eight cut. Eight of these 32 players are going to make it. Who knows who's going to do it? But anyways, remember, guys, we have a long day ahead of us, and let's take a look at the schedule and see exactly what you guys are in for today.
Yeah, so as you can see, we've got five more Swiss rounds, followed by the single elimination top eight, top four, and, of course, the finals. So quite the long tournament. You know, these 17-round tournament. The winner of this tournament will have played 17 rounds over 2 days.
So we're absolutely
grueling, absolutely a test of endurance, so lots more content for you guys today. And it should be really exciting to see this stacked field, how it ends up.
Yeah. Also, remember, man, we've been playing for something. We're not playing for just nothing. We're playing for big prizes that are on the line throughout this entire Pokemon season. I'm pretty sure we have a prizes slide that we're going to be able to show you guys. Yeah, there it is. So we have over $500,000 in scholarships that we're going to be giving out throughout the season, and over $1.5 million are given away in travel awards and prizes. So that is huge. $1.5 million. I can't even wrap my head around that number.
Yeah, it's absolutely unreal. The last year, the prize support as far as trips and stipends went, helping players get to these tournaments and be comfortable at them, was huge. Like, as you saw, $2 million in total prizes being given out through this tournament series. And regionals are really the first step. You know, these are the first big tournaments of the year. The winner of this tournament is going to leave with a nice chunk of championship points and, you know, getting themselves towards earning some of that money.
Yeah, the 2016 season is definitely just gotten started.
There it is.
There's a big announcement that's going on. It looks like we're getting ready to begin the tournament, to begin day two anyway. And remember, we were talking about 30 other players that could be playing. The 30 other players, some of the big names are Dylan Bryan, Nicolina Moon,
Ross Cawthon.
Ross Cawthon. Yeah, how could I forget about Ross? There's so many players that are
Ryan
in the
Sablehouse,
running to the top eight.
A lot of former regional champions, a lot of former Worlds invitees. Just a very, very stacked field we've got for you guys today.
That's right. And now it looks like we're actually going to take a look at the standings. That's awesome. We're going to be able to take a look at exactly where everybody stands here. But this is for the Video Game Masters. So the Video Game Masters division has began. There we go. There's the TCG Masters. And that's Jimmy O'Brien as the top seed at 8-0-1, with Michael Pramawat being the number two seed at 8-1-0. Remember, they are going to be our first match of the day.
Yep, and then you've got Ryan Sablehouse sitting at 7-0-2. Drew Kate, who we saw on the stream yesterday, at 7-1-1. And the important thing to note is, because of the way this tournament works, all of these players are live to win the tournament.
That's right. The seventh seed is Frank Diaz, who happened to be the one who lost to Jimmy O'Brien in the finals at last week's regionals. I wonder if they're going to be able to have a rematch at finals this year.
Yeah, Frank and Jimmy, really good friends, you know, both from the New Jersey area, and I'm sure they're both wanting to see each other in finals.
And we have Dean Azam, Dylan Bryan, and Nicolina Moon in the 8th, 9th, and 10th position. These are huge names in the Pokemon trading card game. For a lot of you guys who follow it as much as I do, you guys know that these players are always at the top, and it's no surprise to me to see them take on Expanded and do so well.
Absolutely, and Damian Hardy and Christopher Veneer ending up at 11 and 12th, lesser-known players, but still very live to win the tournament. You know, an incredible accomplishment making it through 490 players all the way down to just 32.
Yeah, and these are the top 12. There are 20 other people who made it, but these are the top 12, and these are currently the people who you have to look at. They're the people that are most likely to make the top eight here. All they have to do is get something like a 4-1 record to easily get in. Somebody like Jimmy O'Brien, all he has to do is get two wins throughout these next five rounds in order to make the top eight.
Yeah, Jimmy can end up with a 2-3 record at the end of the tournament to make the top eight, which is just unreal.
Yeah, and remember, guys, you guys can always follow us on Twitch, twitch.tv/Pokemon, which is where I'm assuming you guys are at right now, pokemon.com/regionals, Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, and obviously Instagram as well. Can't miss Instagram.
Hey, don't forget that Play Pokemon hashtag.
Yep, hashtag Play Pokemon, hashtag The Streak, hashtag everything, man. There's so many hashtags you can do for this weekend specifically. And I'm just excited to get it started. I know Jimmy and Michael are ready, and I guess that just means that we have to get ready ourselves. So let's kick it off to the how to play video so you guys can see exactly how to learn to play Pokemon, and then maybe you guys can make it here too.
Hello, Pokemon fans. The Pokemon trading card game has been around for over 15 years, but it's easier than ever to learn how to play. This beginner's guide will give you a quick crash course on how the game is played. Pokemon TCG is a strategic Pokemon battle experienced via collectible cards. Two players send their Pokemon cards out onto the field, power them up using energy cards, and support their team using trainer cards. Pokemon are represented by cards in this game. Each player can have up to 6 Pokemon in play at a time. Only the active Pokemon can attack, and the others wait it out on the bench. Pokemon cards that are labeled as basic Pokemon can be put onto the field immediately. Evolution cards can be played on top of basic Pokemon to give them access to stronger attacks. Attacks are fueled by energy cards. In order to use an attack, a Pokemon must have the required amount and type of energy attached to it. Players can attach only one energy card per turn. The energy costs for attacks range from minimal to colossal. Usually the powerful attacks require a lot of energy. Trainer cards can assist in many ways, such as drawing cards, finding a specific Pokemon, or even manipulating energy cards. Each player must use a 60-card deck in the Pokemon TCG. For players competing in the World Championships, typically over half of those cards are trainer cards. They're crucial for executing your strategy and getting the edge over the opposing player. Just like the Pokemon video games, both players take turns having their Pokemon launch attacks at each other. Every Pokemon has a certain amount of hit points, which represents how much damage it can take before being knocked out. When a Pokemon is knocked out, a Pokemon on the bench has to become the new active Pokemon to take its place in battle. The player that scores a knockout gets to draw a prize card. Drawing all of your prize cards is the most common way to win a game of Pokemon, but you can also win if your opponent has no Pokemon left in play, or if your opponent has no cards to draw at the beginning of his or her turn. We've only scratched the surface of the Pokemon TCG in this short video. Watch more of our tournaments to discover other gameplay mechanics, such as special conditions, Pokemon types, including weakness and resistance, game-changing Pokemon abilities, special energy cards, and super powerful Pokemon EX that can Mega Evolve. If you want to start playing the Pokemon TCG yourself, there are plenty of options to try. The Trainer Kit has enough cards for you and a friend to learn how to play together. You can play digitally for free by downloading the Pokemon TCG online, or you can attend local events to learn from other players and compete for prizes.
All right, guys, welcome back, and I hope you guys enjoyed that how to play video. Very well-made video for sure. And I think the players are now ready. I think Jimmy O'Brien and Michael Pramawater are definitely ready. For those of you who tuned in yesterday, the decks are going to be no surprise. Vespa Quinn, which has been Jimmy O'Brien's fairy tale deck of the season, apparently. And then obviously Crobat's with Seismitoad for Pramawat.
Absolutely. Both of these players kind of playing the deck that they're known for, especially Jimmy. You know, the streak, all the wins we talked about earlier have come from Vespa Quinn. So we're going to see two experienced players who understand the matchup for sure.
And the thing is, like, both of these guys have won regionals this season with these decks. So these are, I mean, tournament-proven worthy decks. Landorus, or I'm sorry, I keep saying Landorus, but I meant Seismitoad with Crobat is a big one. This is a deck that that Pram's been playing since for weeks now, and he started playing it at regionals. He wasn't too sure about it week one of regionals, and then all of a sudden he started winning, and he got the big Pram ego going, and then all of a sudden he's like, this is the best deck in the format, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then Vespiquen came out of nowhere week two, and it just obviously dominated, and it inspired so many people to play it this weekend. It was all over the top tables, and five Vespiquen decks actually ended up making the top 32 cut. But actually, the only deck that did better than it happened to be Seismitoad variants. And I guess that's a little unfair since Seismitoad can go with so many other Pokemon, but there's still 12 different Seismitoad decks that make the top 32 cut.
Including 7 copies of Seismitoad Giratina, which I think going into this tournament a lot of players felt was a little overhyped. It did win the Arena Cup in Germany earlier this year, and those European tournaments kind of always set the stage for what's going to happen in the U.S. and elsewhere. And I think that a lot of people, you know, were at first really excited about the deck, and then I've seen a decline in just kind of players' thoughts about it. But 7 copies have made in the top 32. It meant that enough players thought it was good to play it here, thought it was well-positioned. So we'll see.
Yeah, I think we're getting ready for the match. I think we're going to cut to the match right now. But you're absolutely right about the Seismitoad Giratina being one of those decks that for a little while was overhyped, and now it feels like it's underrated.
Right.
Because people are just going like, oh, you know what, it's not really the real deal anymore. It hasn't done well at all at regionals. And then, lo and behold, it's got 7 people in the top 32 cut, which, I mean, it's got to be a favorite to bring at least a couple of people into the top 8.
Absolutely. And, you know, you might be hearing that 7 number thinking it's kind of low, but 7 of 32 players are playing the Seismitoad Giratina deck. And, like you said, 12 players are playing Seismitoad variants in general.
And the handshake did happen. Michael Pramawat and Jimmy O'Brien starting it off. Pram at the left and Jimmy on the right. Jimmy starts with an Eevee start with a Combee and an Unknown. So he clearly looks like he went second here, and he just wanted to bring his hand down to stop himself from really getting hurt by N too badly. And there is an N itself. Pramawat just drops a double color synergy and immediately ends his opponent and himself back to the 6-card hands.
Yeah, so they're going to both go to 6 cards. And you see, as you said, Jimmy did start with that Eevee because he knows he's playing Vespiquen. He's going to have to take a turn to evolve. He knows a Seismitoad can do some real damage in the beginning of the game, and he wants to protect that Vespiquen at all costs. Flareon and Vespiquen, which are both the Pokemon that these Pokemon in Jimmy's field are going to evolve to, both do similar things. You know, they're revenge attacks. However, as you can see, Seismitoad is weak to grass, which is huge.
And Flareon's weak to water. Remember, we can't definitely forget that. A Seismitoad with a Muscle Band will knock out a Flareon, so that's also really important to note. But the Vespiquen, being the grass Pokemon that it is, makes it very easy for it to knock out Seismitoad, even past the Quaking Punch lock. And remember, from here on out, Jimmy's got to be aware of that Quaking Punch, which is going to happen, given the double color synergy that's already been attached to Pram's Seismitoad.
Yeah, Quaking Punch has just been the story of the past few standard formats. This expanded format now, just absolutely an incredibly powerful attack, and you're going to see Jimmy O'Brien playing a lot of items this turn. Not sure the contents of his hand, but he's definitely going to try and play all the items he can. As you said, he knows that Pram has that double colorless on the Seismitoad ready to go, and he needs to thin his deck out. He needs to not draw items. He needs to use all the items he can, and he needs to be prepared to play a game in which he can play no more items, maybe throughout the entire game.
Yeah, so that just basically means that he's got to play as many items as he can on this given turn. That Battle Compressor is the perfect item for him to play on turn one. He needs to get a certain amount of Pokemon into his discard pile so that Revenge and Be Revenge and all that good stuff do as much damage as they need to in order for the Seismitoad to get knocked out. Pramawat is really fearing these knockouts from the Vespiquen early on. That's how Pramawat loses the game. However, he wins the game when Vespiquen kind of stutters at the beginning of the game.
Yeah, and I think Battle Compressor is really the key. We saw Jimmy play against a Seismitoad deck yesterday, and although he did end up winning that match, there were some rough times, especially when he didn't get Battle Compressors. Those early Battle Compressors to not only, you know, thin your deck, it's an item you can play early, but also put the Pokemon in the discard pile, which is exactly where he wants them to be. So being able to play 2 Battle Compressors on the first turn is going to be absolutely huge for Jimmy, and he follows it up with a Versus Seeker for that Juniper.
That's right. So Juniper does draw him 7 additional cards, but that is his supporter for the turn. Now Pram's going to look through the discard pile, see how many Pokemon are in the discard pile. I think it's something along the lines of like 2 or 3. The Battle Compressor actually ended up getting a couple of non-Pokemon cards, I believe.
Yeah, that's one of the.
He always has an unknown in the bench.
That's one of the beautiful things about the Battle Compressor. You know, we've been talking about it a lot in the context of the Vespiquen deck, which says, you know, you're going to put a bunch of Pokemon in there and boost your B Revenge attack. However, you can also put, as you saw Jimmy do, didn't have a supporter in his hand. He Battle Compressors away a Juniper, plays the Versus Seeker in his hand, gets a Juniper back, and all of a sudden it's a supporter.
And I hate to be the bearer of bad news for Pramalot fans, but it seems like all he can do right now is play an immediate end. So the only two cards that he's played outside of the Double Colossus and the Seismitoad, and I guess the Stadium is, are just ends. That's basically how his turn began. Now, he has to hope to draw something beyond what he's got here because he runs, you know, he's definitely in danger of getting knocked out here from a Vespiquen and, like, maybe a Timely Juniper or something like that.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the, as we said before, the Vespiquen can take advantage of that Seismitoad grass weakness and really do some early damage. It looks like Pram's going to be able to survive, though. Looks like he's got that Zubat. He has a computer search in his hand, so he's got some things going on.
And all Pram does here is Quaking Punch. He decides not to use his computer search too early. He still has no idea exactly how strong of a start Jimmy has. And Jimmy does immediately evolve to two Flareons. Remember, Flareon not at its strongest against Seismitoad. However, he still has plenty of cards to work with. However, he just passes Flareon Evolution, and then an immediate pass. He just wanted to bring the Flareon down in order for it to, well, currently it can still survive a Quaking Punch, but more importantly than that, he'll still be able to get two Pokemon into the discard pile once the Flareon does get knocked out.
Absolutely. You can see, I know Jimmy has a Shaymin EX in his hand. Can't use it because of that Silent Lamp. He also has the Unknown with the Farewell Letter ability. And besides that, I think he just has a bunch of item cards in his hand. And this has kind of been the story of the weekend with Seismitoad EX. Just, you know, your opponent has a bunch of cards they can't use in their hand. It's not very easy for them to win the game.
That's right. Remember that the Unknown cannot be used currently. So we have to keep that in mind. We can't just assume that he can Unknown pass the Silent Lab or anything like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Silent Lab, super powerful card in decks like these. You know, Pram has no basic Pokemon that are really going to use abilities, and he can definitely sequence his plays in ways where he can take advantage of his own abilities and stop Jimmy from using his.
Golbat does come down and brings 20 damage onto the benched Combi. That can prove to be extremely strong if Jimmy doesn't find a Vespiquen immediately, because then any type of Crobat evolution or another Golbat that can come down would mean the end of that specific Combi. Another Seismitoad does come down with a Double Colossus Energy. And besides that, Pram's hand seems to be, that seems to be it for Pram's hand. But he's thinking about playing the Hypnotoxic Laser. I think you do here, and he does. You just want to get that quick knockout of the Flareon. You don't want to give the Vespiquen too many turns to set up past your Quaking Punch lock.
Yeah, and we are going to see the Quaking Punch for the knockout after factoring in resistance. Just one prize for Pram, which is kind of the name of the game. You know, one of the reasons that this Vespiquen deck is so powerful is because every knockout that your opponent's going to be taking is only going to be for one prize, whereas when you're getting a knockout, you're taking two prizes. So that's, you know, that math works out really well, and hopefully you can take advantage of that. That's what Jimmy's going to aim to do throughout the tournament.
One thing to note is that Jimmy had the opportunity to use Farewell Letter on his Unknown early on, but maybe it's the fact that it's so early in the morning and we haven't gotten too much sleep, but he just honestly neglected to do so before ending his turn, and then Pramalot immediately punished him with that Silent Lab.
We saw Pram drop the Crobat, put three damage counters on that Vespiquen, take a prize, and force Jimmy to promote something else that's likely going to get knocked out this term. So Pram definitely in the driver's seat.
Yeah, he really is. It seemed like Jimmy had a great start, but it just didn't deliver anything else past the first few cards. And that Silent Lab has just been destroying Jimmy, because I believe he has a Shaman in hand that he's had for a while now, and he hasn't been able to play it just because Silent Lab is honestly just the perfect counter to that card, especially when Jimmy doesn't play any counter stadiums, I don't believe.
Nope, not a one.
Yeah, so that Silent Lab is there to stay. Pramalot does not have any counter stadiums for the Silent Lab, and neither does Jimmy, so no more abilities from basic Pokemon from here on out.
And we do see that Pramalot attaches the Muscle Band to that Seismitoad, going to allow him to get the knockout if he can find a Hypnotoxic Laser on this Unknown, which isn't too important, but keeping the pressure on is, you know, he just definitely wants to take prizes and kind of mitigate the advantage that Jimmy has as far as taking two prizes versus Pramalot's one, as we were saying before.
Exactly. Now, remember, Jimmy does still have some time to work with here. Seismitoad is not particularly known for its aggression. It doesn't deal too much damage right away, but also because of Zubat and Crobat, Golbat and Crobat, the unknown can definitely survive this Quaking Punch, but it would still go down to a Golbat coming down on Pram's following turn. However, it didn't end up mattering because Pram did find the Hypnotoxic Laser, and down went that unknown.
Yeah, now Pram's in a really solid position. You know, he's up three prizes. Looks like Jimmy's struggling to put together anything. There's the Vespiquen from Jimmy, but without a double colorless energy, it's not going to matter too much. The advantage that Jimmy's had here is that he has been able to keep two Combis on the bench, so if anything were to happen to one, he has another to evolve in the Vespiquen, but I think it might just be too little too late at this point. Pram could easily run off with this game. And, you know, that's one game out of the match. He'd advanced to 9 wins. It's a pretty big game, but...
Yeah, this we'll is see. Also a big game for Pram. He's also 2 wins away from making the top 8. So just like Jimmy, all he really needs to do is just secure 2 wins. If either of these players can get this win, then that just means that they're 1 win away with 4 rounds to go. So they're all but secure to make a top 8 run after having won a regionals earlier this season. Now, at the same time, remember, Jimmy's streak is on the line. This is a big thing. It's so rare to have such a good record throughout a season, and let alone in a couple of weekend stretch. So this is actually really important for this player, for Jimmy. I'm sure that he would love to keep the undefeated streak going, not just for point's sake, but just for history's sake.
Oh, absolutely. This has got to be one of the, if not the most impressive regional streak, you know, winning a regional undefeated, moving into day 2 undefeated. I mean, it's, Jimmy's got to feel happy, but with that comes the need to just want to increase the streak. You know, I can't imagine it would be the most dominant regional performance ever. I'm sure if he were able to win 2 regionals, much less undefeated, would just be amazing.
It's right up there with Israel Sosa's 3 regionals wins in 1 season. It's right up there with that. So, I mean, we're talking about history that could be definitely in the making here, but Jimmy does have to find a way to win this round. Let alone this game. This game is just looking awful for Jimmy. Pram is still in the driver's seat. It seems like even when Pram doesn't have any supporters, he seems to top deck one right on his following turn. So Pram, once again, firing on all cylinders, and down comes a Golbat. The Golbat is going to strike onto the Combi, actually, instead of the Eevee. And now an Ultra Ball is probably going to find him another Golbat in order for that Eevee to go down, I would assume. Or no, actually, the Combi would go down.
He can sneaky bite the Combi, knock out the Eevee with the attack, and go down to 1 single prize.
Exactly.
And there it is, a sneaky bite, placing 2 damage counters onto that Combi for the knockout.
And now a super scoop up there would be big, but no, he did not land that super scoop up. Had he landed that super scoop up, the Eevee would also be going down through a sneaky bite. But it was not meant to be, and down goes Eevee with a Quaking Punch. And Pram does go down to a single prize. Vespiquen in the active position, a Flareon, which gets knocked out immediately from a Quaking Punch on the bench. Jimmy's time is running desperately out.
Yeah, I think it might just be too little too late, you know. Jimmy has 6 prize cards remaining to Pram's 1, attaching the basic fire energy there and playing in the end. So
Jimmy now ends his opponent to 1. If there's any chance of him winning this game, it's going to be through this. An end to 1 brings Pram Awad down to a single card in hand, but with a Seismitoad with no damage on the active position, a Seismitoad with a double colorless on the bench, and then even a Seismitoad on the bench with a single water energy, Pram Awad's pretty much as prepared as you can be, even past this end to 1.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, that's the way, you know, it's pretty unlikely that Jimmy wins this game at this point, but if he does, this is how it's done. You know, and Pram low, put him to a low amount of cards, and hope to be able to take the game. Looks like he's just going to intelligence gathering for 20, draw back up to 6.
Jimmy actually plays that
in order to
avoid maybe escape rope shenanigans. I like that play. Jimmy's still playing pretty much at peak level, even in this awful position.
Absolutely. We saw that Pram Awad drew the Juniper off the end of 1. Just got to be so frustrating for Jimmy. You know, you end your opponent to 1, hoping they don't draw anything. Look how many cards are left in his deck, but he just draws the best card casually.
Man, it is Pram Awad, all right? These are things that you just have to assume are going to happen when you're playing against Pram. And now I believe it goes 2 Ultra Balls in a row. The first one found a Crobat. I believe the second one's going to find a Crobat as well. That's going to be 60 damage placed onto the Vespiquen just through Crobat alone, which means that Seismitoad's attack is going to be more than enough to knock out this Vespiquen. And down goes Jimmy for game 1. Jimmy is 1 game away from seeing his first defeat in 2 weekends.
Yeah, absolutely. We saw that game was just absolutely brutal and really showcased the power of Seismitoad EX. You know, we had, like you said, Jimmy had a perfectly reasonable start. He got some Combis on the bench, started with some Eevees, Battle Compressor to weigh some stuff. You know, was really, he had a first turn Juniper, was really getting somewhere. But as soon as that Quaking Punch hit, we saw what happened. Jimmy just had no resources, couldn't play any of the items in his hand, couldn't find that double color energy to attack, and just, it's so hard to fight through a Quaking Punch, and we really saw how just how dominant that can be.
Yeah, this is a matchup that actually proved, I hoped that we would see fireworks in it. I really did. Like, when I saw, round 10, Jimmy O'Brien against Michael Paramowat table 1, I was just like, oh, man, this has all the makings to be a classic match. But game 1 has just been utter dominance. I'm hoping that game 2 is definitely a different story. I want to see a very competitive match here. Both of these players are obviously some of the two of the best players in the world right now, and they seem to know Expanded better than almost anybody.
Yeah, and I think we will. You know, this match, Pram 6-0, Jimmy, this isn't really indicative of the matchup, I think. Seismitoad, very powerful. But like we said, Vespa Quinn can play off of that weakness, and I think that the matchup is closer than that game would show. And that's why we're playing best of three Swiss here. You know, we're giving every player a chance. We know that bad draws happen. We know that, you know, sometimes just luck isn't on your side. So the best of three Swiss helps to mitigate that. And, yeah, I'm hoping we see a really close match. Regardless of the way it goes, you know, I know that Jimmy would love to keep the streak alive. I know that Pram's itching to be the one to end the streak. So we'll have to see how it goes.
That's right. And you know what? Speaking of people who really know the expanded format, you have to kind of feel like there is an upper echelon of players who truly got to understand the format. People like Jimmy O'Brien and Frank Diaz, Michael Paramowat, these guys have seen repeated success throughout these three weekends. And then there's people like JP, for example, who not only top aided or actually became a finalist in week one's Arizona Regionals, but he actually ended up winning Vancouver Regionals last night.
Yeah, Jonathan Perinata, a Seattle player, ended up, like Josue said, second at Arizona, losing to Israel Sosa in the finals, and then came back for last night's Vancouver British Columbia Regional Championship and ended up taking first place. So we've seen a lot of this kind of dominance at the top tables. You know, now we're looking at Jonathan Perinata has a first and a second. Jimmy O'Brien has a first, undefeated, you know, moving in, maybe going to make the top eight here, very likely. We have Frank Diaz, Michael Pramer, all these players who are just really showcasing how good they are at the format.
Exactly. And now there's the handshake. Game 2 is about to begin. Now Jimmy O'Brien is going to be the very first player to draw a card here in this game 2. Two Combi start for Jimmy and a Dedenne start for Pram.
Yeah, definitely not what Pram wants to see. You know, the Dedenne start, not really very useful versus this deck. It's Dedenne is a lightning type Pokemon in there to kind of take advantage of Evil Tall EX, weakness to lightning and things like that. So not the ideal start, but with cards like Super Scoop Up and kind of all the consistent item cards that Pram is running, it's very possible that it doesn't cause him too much trouble.
Yeah, and a big Battle Compressor once again for Jimmy on turn one, as well as an unknown start. These are big cards for Jimmy to draw early on. Remember, we need to see these cards come out of Jimmy on turn one because he's not guaranteed to be able to play them at any other point of the game. And right away we see, I believe, three Pokemon hit the discard pile for Jimmy.
Yeah, I think there was a Battle Compressor for an Audino and two unknowns. Couldn't quite see the first card because of the glare. But
and now an Ultra Ball is going to discard a Jirachi, I believe, as well as another item. And it's going to find Jimmy a Shaman. So he's getting rid of all of these ability Pokemon now while he still can. In order to be able to avoid getting Silent Labbed out of the game again.
Yeah, when Pram plays that Silent Lab, it is going to go unopposed. You know, one of the things about stadium cards is that your opponent can play one and knock yours out, but Jimmy is playing no stadiums here, so once that Silent Lab hits, it will stick for the rest of the game.
Exactly, and we saw that actually ended up being one of the determining factors in game one, and that's why Jimmy couldn't really come back, because he was relying on the Shaman, which he could never actually play. So now Jimmy understands the deck and the matchup a little bit better coming into game 2, and he Ultra Balls for another unknown in order to be able to use it right now rather than just kind of have it sit dead in his hand and in play later on.
Absolutely. Not only is he going to be able to activate that Farewell Letter and draw a card, but it's also going to put a basic Pokemon, or put a Pokemon in general, in Jimmy's discard pile, fuel that Be Revenge attack, and this is certainly a good start from Jimmy. You know, we've seen him have a good start like this before, and then ultimately that Quaking Punch proves too strong, but if Jimmy's going to win this match, this is how it's going to be done. You know, a lot of items, a lot of cards being drawn in the first turn. Getting the double Combi starts, absolutely amazing.
That start from Jimmy is insane. Now he Ultra Balled again, this time finding another Shaman. That's a second Shaman activation of the game, and now a second Battle Compressor activation of the game. This is Jimmy O'Brien's deck firing on all cylinders, and as long as he doesn't forget to discard the Unknown here for another card, he's going to have drawn so many cards throughout this turn one.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is really what you want to see. Like we said before, I personally think the Battle Compressor is one of the best cards in the format and really in this matchup, really important to fire off on one of the first few turns. I'm really interested to see what Pram has in his hand and how his turn goes, because one thing we've seen throughout this tournament with the Vespiquen decks is that reliance on double colorless energy.
Another computer search now.
Oh, wow.
This is Jimmy once again getting all of his cards that he needs. Gets another Combi. That's three Combis in play, as well as two Shamans and an Unknown. And now I don't even think he's played a supporter yet. And no, he is not.
Well,
he's drawing another seven cards, this time with Juniper. This is this has been like the 30th cards that he's seen this turn.
And I'd love for Jimmy here to hit a double close energy. Like I was saying, that's kind of been the bottleneck of his deck. I feel like when you can't play those items, when you know you're not drawing a whole lot of cards for the turn, it can be really difficult to hit those very few energy you run. There's the Farewell Letter activation. Draws Jimmy a Silver Bangle. Certainly a card he's going to want to play as soon as possible. And does Pram run any energy removal? Is there any Enhanced Hammers in the list?
I don't believe so, but let's take a look real quick. Yes, there is actually. There's two Enhanced Hammers in Pram's list.
Okay, that's what I thought, yeah. So that's definitely a factor, too. You know, Vespiquen's attack does take two energy, so usually, you know, that's formed with just a double colorless. But because it is special energy, Pram can remove them with the Enhanced Hammer.
And Jimmy's turn finally ends here, it seems. There might be a little bit of confusion as to whether or not it's ended. But no, there it is. Pram draws his card for the turn. He actually draws the Enhanced Hammer we were just talking about. But Pram finally gets to see any type of cards. And there it is. There's a quick Juniper for six cards. Pram has to discard away so many supporters and potentially good items here. And like, for example, the Enhanced Hammer we were just talking about. But he needed to see a new card, a new hand of seven, because that Dene start with nothing else just was not going to cut it.
Yeah, and we did see, you know, we've been talking about Silent Lab so much. And you see the Pramawat ends up discarding it off of the Juniper, and that's just because, you know, he is running Pokemon with abilities. He does have Shaman EX of his own, and he can't risk playing that Silent Lab and then Junipering and having a Shaman that can draw more cards and not being able to do so. He's in a rough spot. He knows that Jimmy, the ball is definitely in Jimmy's court. Jimmy is getting pretty well set up, and he knows that he might need a Shaman this turn. He needs to do all that he can to have just as good of a setup as Jimmy.
Exactly. Now, Pramawat at this point is going to find himself a Seismitoad. He does still need to get some sort of offense going. That Dedenne start is obviously not ideal, but he needs to find a way around this. Ideally, it'd be a Super Scoop Up right now, or, yeah, I mean, it has to be a Super Scoop because he's already used the supporter for the turn.
Yeah, absolutely, and we're going to see.
I believe he does have the Super Scoop Up in hand, but no, actually, it's just a Shaman, a lowly Shaman for five cards.
Not the perfect Shaman, but, you know, five cards will do.
Okay, we do see a Super Scoop Up in Pram's hand now, so he can definitely go for it. I don't know if he has a double colorless yet or not, but either way, there's a Super Scoop Up. Heads on the Super Scoop Up. He actually has to pick up the Shaman because I don't believe he had the double colorless in hand.
Yeah, so what Pram's really looking for here is a way to get that Dedenne out of the active position, a way to promote that Seismitoad, and then the double colorless, like you said, to attack with. So,
Pram actually discards a Super Scoop Up from his hand here off an Ultra Ball. So that actually tells me a little bit about what Pram's strategy is, and that's that he's not that interested in getting his Dedenne out of the active position. That's a little interesting to me because, I don't know, I would assume that the other two cards in his hand are just, I mean, obviously one is him Shaman, but I guess the other card in his hand is just too important for him.
The thing is, the decision he has to make is, with Jimmy having this kind of start, it's very possible that Pram, even if he gets the Quaking Punch, you know, he says, hey, Quaking Punch, 30 damage, and Jimmy just goes, okay, I'll evolve the Vespiquen, and I'll attach a double colorless and knock you out. Because like we said before, that grass weakness on Seismitoad is a very big deal in this matchup.
A laser from Pramawat does put the Combi to sleep. That's 10 damage per turn onto the Combi because of poison, plus the sleep that it now has to wake up from. Is that going to be the end of Pram's turn? No energy still. And that is the end of Pram's turn. Now Jimmy has to flip to see if he wakes up. He does not. So now the Combi has to evolve to Vespiquen in order for it to start its in order for Jimmy to have any type of offense.
And we do see the double colorless and the Vespiquen in Jimmy's hand. Unsure of how many Pokemon are in the discard pile, but definitely having the double colorless and the Vespiquen is going to put Jimmy in a pretty good place here. Looks like He has some item cards, too, that he actually gets to use past turn one.
Yeah, so, like, for example, the Vespiquen will be able to knock out the Seismitoad for sure. It's just a matter of whether whether he's got enough prize or Pokemon in the discard pile for maybe, like, a Crobat knockout as well from a Vespiquen.
Yeah, and then we see Jimmy just played the Hex Maniac, so no abilities for Pram this turn. He's going to have no sneaky bites, no setups, nothing like that. And that's really where Hex Maniac can shine, is just in these turns where Jimmy's going, all right, I'm going to knock you out. You know, I'm going to gain an advantage. Also, you can't play abilities next turn, so have fun getting set up.
Another laser from Pramawatt also puts the Vespiquen to sleep. That now, this one can prove to be very important. At this point, the Vespiquen has to wake up. I do not believe that Jimmy has any ways around sleep besides that. I don't think I see any type of, like, switching effects for Jimmy.
He does have an Audino in his deck.
But he already discarded.
But he discarded on turn one with the Battle Compressor.
Yeah. So we do see a double colors for Seismitoad. Finally, we're going to see an attack from Pram. It seems like it's been forever, but it's actually only turn three.
Yeah, there's the double colors finally off that computer search. Muscle band attached, and you're right. This sleep flip, is going to be pretty big. You know, Pramawatt got the heads in the first laser to put the Combi to sleep. Not really a big deal. You know, if Combi evolves, it wakes up. But this one can definitely be big.
Yeah. Pramawatt does use his Versus Seeker in order to draw seven more cards with the Juniper. And now that, okay, there is a Silent Lab, that's exactly what Pram needed to see here. He wanted to avoid any type of, like, potential abilities that could ruin his day. He wanted to lock that in as soon as possible. And now it's up to the sleep flip in order for Jimmy to really start dominating this game. The sleep flip is huge, and Jimmy catches him in air. Sleep flip, he does not wake up. That is huge for Pramawatt here. That means that Jimmy is not going to be able to attack this following turn, and the double colorless and the Vespiquen are both going to go down.
Absolutely, and this is something where, you know, we can see what happened last game happen again, where Jimmy, just, he doesn't have Vespiquens. He doesn't have the double colorless. Now Pram's going to deal with his only threat on the board, and now Jimmy has to find those cards. He has to find the Vespiquens. He has to find the double colorless. He has to find something to do, and wow, that sneaky bite. Going to take out that Vespiquen, and now Jimmy's forced to promote something and let it get hit by that Seismitoad. What a turn. Pram really used his second turn to turn this game around.
This is a huge turn of events for Pramawatt here. The fact that the Vespiquen did not wake up really put Jimmy in a tough spot, followed by the Golbat activation, does knock out the Vespiquen, forces the Eevee to come into the active position, and now another laser puts that Eevee to sleep, and more importantly, is going to knock out that Eevee. Now a Combi takes 20 additional damage from another sneaky bite here.
Yeah, and that Combi is in range of getting sneaky bit for the knockout, and, you know, there's still a lot of game to be played. Both players sitting with five prize cards left, going to draw five off this end, but definitely Pram is advantaged here. You know, and we could see the streak be ended, Grim.
Yeah, no kidding. It seemed like Jimmy was going to win this game too with ease, but some timely Pram luck trademark is really bringing Pram right back into this game.
And it just goes to show you know, sometimes the first few turns can be sort of strange, you know. We saw Jimmy get a pretty good setup. Pram struggled in the first couple turns, but then it came back. You know, there's a lot of skill in Pokemon. There's a lot of things that can change as the turns go on.
And now Vespiquen does become active for Jimmy. Another Eevee comes down, but remember, he still needs a double colorless energy.
I do see it in his hand.
There is a double colorless, so this is going to mean that this Seismitoad is going to go down, and Jimmy is going to go down to three prizes as opposed to Pram's four, but this is not before Jimmy plays an N in order to draw himself five additional cards and Pram only four.
Yeah, and this is the absolute best time for Jimmy to play the N. He is taking two prizes this turn, so these are the most cards he's ever going to get off of an N for the rest of the game.
Exactly. Not unimportantly is the fact that Pram is going to go down to a four-card hand, which really limits his options.
Yeah, so four cards, and as you can see, Pramawatt does have the water attached to that Seismitoad, but he's going to need to find another energy to be able to attack next turn.
This is actually a pretty decent four-card hand for Pram. He finds two double colorless energies and a super scoop-up, which can always mean more damage for Golbat and Crobat.
Absolutely. We see Pram promoting the Golbat, taking some time to think about what's in his hand. He does find that double colorless energy for the Seismitoad.
Now remember that this is actually kind of important, that the Vespiquen will likely not get knocked out here. We don't see a laser or any type of potential Golbat activations for Pram here. So that means that the Vespiquen will not be knocked out, which means it's going to be able to knock out an additional Seismitoad here. Super Scoop Up here from Pramawat is heads. Super Scoop Up is going to bring back the Shaman. Remember that it cannot actually use its ability because of Silent Lab, but still, it's not going to be an easy knockout for Jimmy.
And we can see the Vespiquen get knocked out if Pram can find a Crobat. Because Pram can put 3 damage counters on that Vespiquen, going up to 4 damage counters, and then he can deal 50 damage with that Seismitoad.
So now, remember, Pram's pretty much out of Super Scoop Ups by now. He might have one remaining, but that is not many. Brings back, I believe, a Crobat line, or maybe 2 Crobats and a Golbat. Pram definitely wants to see another Zubat come down into his bench. At least one, definitely. But he's almost out of Super Scoop Ups. This is going to be rough for Pram. It actually seems like Jimmy's right back in the lead here.
Yeah, absolutely. I think if Pram just needs to get that Crobat down, he needs to start taking prizes here, and he needs to hope that there's no more double colorless for Jimmy in there.
He did have a Crobat in hand. That Crobat was huge. That actually means the Vespiquen's going to go down. Remember, Crobat is going to deal 30 damage to that Vespiquen, putting it at 40 damage, 50 hit points left, which means a Quaking Punch from Seismitoad is going to knock out the Vespiquen. I did not see that Crobat in Pram's hand.
Yeah, and it looks like there's no double colorless for Jimmy, just the basic fire energy in hand. So we can see the same thing next turn. You know, we did see Pram shovel that Crobat back into his deck. Another Sneaky Bite activation and another Quaking Punch could knock out that Vespiquen, but it looks like Jimmy's going to go ahead and just retreat, protect the Vespiquen. Very great idea, switching into that Shaman EX.
That was enormous for Pram. I had no idea he had that Crobat. That Crobat ended up making all the difference there. That's exactly the Pokemon that Pramawat needed in order to bring himself right back into this game. And now Lysander brings up the Flareon. Flareon is going to get knocked out in one hit because of Quaking Punch, and it's going to bring Pram down to 2 prizes remaining.
Yeah, absolutely. And now Jimmy's going to promote that Vespiquen. The Vespiquen does have free retreat, so not a big deal to promote that guy and just see what happens. But with 2 prizes remaining to Jimmy's 3, no double colorless in Jimmy's hand. He's got an uphill battle ahead of him, to say the least.
The streak is definitely on the line here. The streak is in danger of being over. Pramawat is unreal. Pramawat is just unreal here. And now Shaman does start Sky Returning. Brings both himself and 2 fire energies back to Jimmy's hand, activates a new Shaman. Shaman will likely not get knocked out here, but still, Jimmy's just on the ropes here.
Oh, there's a laser and a head. That Shaman's going to stay asleep. You see Jimmy shaking his head. I think that's the 3rd laser heads in a row that Pramawat's gotten.
An end now from Mike is going to bring both players down to very low hand sizes. 2 for Pram. 3 for Jimmy. And remember, Jimmy's Shaman is asleep. Jimmy has basically no real aggression going here, and he needs to find a way to get the Shaman into the out of the active position as soon as possible.
Yeah, so that Shaman will go to 60 damage after the poison, and if that is left active, that's going to be the game. We see that Jimmy's hand does not appear to have any outs. It's going to be a big flip.
Big flip for Jimmy. Tails. The Shaman stays asleep. Is this going to be the end of the game? Jimmy needs something. Anything.
Looks like he's considering playing at Professor Juniper. Yeah, he's just got
to
do
it. Jimmy draws 7 additional cards here. He needs to draw something, some sort of a way to get himself out of this position. Does he find it? No,
and that's
we see a handshake.
The streak is over.
The streak is over. Jimmy O'Brien extends his hand. Michael Pramawat wins this round and is now 9-1 going into round 11. 4 rounds to go for Pram. He needs 1 more win. Jimmy still needs 2. Both of these players are very live for top 8, but man, was that a match for the ages.
Wow.
Jimmy has finally been defeated. Pramawat is looking as strong as ever, and after his week 1 regionals win, he has now taken down the undefeated top-seeded player, and he is in prime position in the number 1 seed right now to make the top 8.
And it's like we said, you know, Pram called it. He called a shot. This morning I was walking through the hotel lobby. I said, hey, congrats on making day 2. Good luck. He said, man, I just want Jimmy. They wouldn't give me Jimmy yesterday. And look what happened. He has broken the streak. Wow.
Pramawat is confident as ever. He's definitely unique in that sense, in that he truly believes he's the best player in the game right now. And he's definitely proving it right here. He's just jumping for joy. Finally the one to defeat Jimmy. Jimmy O'Brien has had an incredible run throughout this regional season, and the streak is finally ended.
Yeah, and let's not count Jimmy out. He has 8 wins. Now he's going to need 2 more wins, roughly, out of his next 4 rounds. So, you know, definitely he can put together a top 8 here, and, you know, it's not
the streak is over, but his tournament certainly is not.
Exactly. I really hope you guys have been enjoying this. This is a great way for us to start this day two of action. We started day one of action with Michael Pramilat against Jason Glazinski, which was a rematch to the finals of week one's regionals. Now we see day two action start with Michael Pramilat against Jimmy O'Brien, which is two regionals champions from this season. Wow.
Yeah, it's been absolutely amazing. Pramilat has just, he's running through all of these legends of the game, all the top players right now, and he's very live to win this tournament.
This is a strong case for being the best player in the game right now. But anyways, give us a moment to get a small break and get Pramilat onto the stage here for a quick interview. All right, guys, welcome back. I am Josue Crims Rojano here with Michael Pramilat, my good friend, and the Streak Slayer.
Oh, man. I was so excited because yesterday I was second seed and he was first seed and we didn't get to play. So I was like, I'm gonna end the streak right now.
I mean, you knew coming into today that this was going to be the match for round one for you, right?
Yeah, I was pretty sure. I was like, unless something weird happens, I was pretty confident I was going to play him round one.
How confident were you in the matchup coming into it?
I think it's favorable if I go first, but if he goes first, I have to, as you guys saw, I have to get lucky with laser. I have to get like one heads-tails combination. I think I got like two or three.
I think we need to trademark the hypnotoxic laser heads-tails into like some sort of a pram thing, like maybe you got prammed.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, as soon as Quaking Punch happens, I just have to get, I only have to stop one Vespa Queen from going too crazy. And so you have to get the one heads tails combination, but if
only one.
I mean, you play four lasers, it might happen.
It does happen. It happens pretty often when you're Michael Pramilat.
Yeah, yeah.
Pram, I know for a long time you've considered yourself to be one of the best in the game. I mean, it's true, and you've made a strong case for it, given you all of your results throughout your entire career. What makes you think that, or what makes you stand out this season in particular compared to before?
I think I'm just playing the right deck, to be honest. Like, this format's, a lot of people are just trying to combo off, and my deck's just like, no, I don't like it when you get the do that.
Well, we started day one with you winning against Jason Glazinski in a rematch of the finals of week one. Now we see day two start with you winning against Jimmy O'Brien in a matchup between two champions of the season. So, I mean, if that means anything, that would mean that you're pretty much the favorite coming into the top eight here, assuming you get another win.
Yeah, I think I only have to win like one more,
I think,
and
so
then
too.
I'm just in, and I could just like do whatever for the next three rounds, but
ID
or something, you know.
Dream crush.
Yeah, I think I could lose all three and be in still.
Yeah.
It's like weird. They're good, but they just kept playing combo. Like everyone's playing combo decks, and I'm just sitting here playing the control deck, and I'm just like, well, you know, you don't get to do what you want to do. I win.
It's true. Yeah. Well, yeah, man, I hope to see you again up here in the stage. I hope to be able to interview you at least a few more times, maybe see you as a champion. Definitely looks like it's possible. I'm excited to see exactly how far your run goes, man.
Yeah, I'm trying to maybe get two wins. Two wins
two
and three.
Wins.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then maybe a couple more in top.
Yeah.
All right, man. Well, thanks a lot. Stay tuned, guys. Remember, round 11 is coming up pretty soon. Don't leave your seat.